years before he is destined to take a giant stride into history, Colonel John H. Glenn, Jr. squeezes into his spacesuit. His smiling face belies the 10 postponements of his flight that have kept him grounded.
Many times. I went on the 11th scheduled date. Yeah, but I was up on top and actually ready to go on two previous occasions.
This morning, the weather over Cape Canaveral and in the pickup areas is better. And there's an air of optimism as the colonel walks to the gantry elevator. Carrying his now familiar portable air conditioner, Glenn prepares to go to the 11th deck as clocks point to 6 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. The skies are beginning to lighten and a cool north wind rustles across the Cape.
And we've done this, as I said, had done this three times before, so we came down to that particular day and run away out. I guess I couldn't really believe that we're going to go that day, but it worked out that we did.
The colonel's date with destiny comes 10 months after the Russians claimed an orbital flight by Yuri Gagarin.
I think people forget back at that time, this was in the depths of the Cold War. And we were in a contest with the Soviet Union, and they had boosters, of course, that were operating well when ours were too often blowing up on the launch pad. That was a lot of the impetus driving the early days of the space program.
This is the climax of 3 years of training. This is the moment when the eyes of the world turn to Cape Canaveral. The Russian orbits were in a thick fog of secrecy. The United States stands or falls in the white-hot glare of worldwide publicity. In the capsule atop the Atlas missile, the colonel will be strapped to a contoured couch. Once in flight, the Mercury will be tilted so that the astronaut will ride backwards.
Really plugging in, you slide into this thing. It's not very big. And it's we used to joke about the spacecraft. We said you didn't get into it. You actually put it on. It was more like putting on clothes. It was that small, because the whole thing, if you spread your arms out like that, you were touching both sides of the spacecraft.
The seconds tick off as his rendezvous with space approaches. The hatch cover causes a slight delay when a defective bolt is discovered. Then millions are moved to silent prayer.
And so I've been through this before, and so the day of the launch, when it actually occurred, I could hardly believe it when they got down to the 18-second automatic count. I thought, wait a minute, there's something wrong here, we're not going to cancel.
Everything is gold. The takeoff of the Atlas, blasted off by 360,000 pounds of thrust, carries the Mercury gracefully skyward. Friendship 7, climbing rapidly out of the Earth's atmosphere, exerts a pressure of 6 times the force of gravity on the astronaut. Loud and clear, he reports back to Mercury Control, reading off his instruments, commenting on his reactions, all as coolly and calmly as if he was commuting on the 827.
And that, of course, I was glad to get going. There's a lot of misconception, I think, still in a lot of people. They look at a liftoff, and they see all the fire and the smoke and everything is going, and they think the astronaut must be going through real torture inside, tremendous pressures and all, and it's quite the opposite. You have to remember that the rocket booster, the engines, just have enough thrust to barely get that whole heavy booster going. And so it's a very gentle liftoff as you come up, and as the fuel burns out, then the thrust is remaining the same, and so you're going faster after you get, and you get into the maximum G forces that you feel on your body are just before you get into orbit, when the fuel is down very light and the thrust is still there from the engines. And so you're accelerating, and on the Mercury flight got up to about almost 8 times gravity, about 7.9, but it was in this direction instead of this direction, as it would be if you're sitting up in a fighter airplane. Well, it looks very impressive from the outside. The astronaut is not under any big stress inside during that period of time.
Now comes the moment when the Mercury is turned so that Glenn will be seated facing backwards. He checks with ground control.
Roger, 0G, and I feel fine. Capsule is turning around. Oh, that view is tremendous. Roger, turnaround has started. Capsule turning around, and I could see the booster during turnaround just a couple of hundred yards behind me. It was beautiful. Roger, 7. You have a go, at least 7 orbits.
Roger, understand go for at least 7 orbits.
People have tried to equate it with floating in a swimming pool or something like that, but it's not that, or being underwater and being balanced. And you don't get the same feeling. When you're in space, you're completely free to float. If I pushed off from the desk here and pushed up and we were in space, I'd just float on up to the ceiling. You can push off there. And once you're up there in our steady state into zero G, well, it's very comfortable.
Actual pictures of Glenn in the capsule will give scientists the opportunity to study his reactions.
One of the unusual things about this, I don't know, people might notice down at the lower part on my chest, looks like a round mirror, which is exactly what it is. And that mirror is a parabolic, slightly curved mirror. And the purpose of it was, since the camera was mounted on the instrument panel that was taking pictures of me, this could be used then as a backup on what the instrument readings were on the instrument panel by having the mirror look back the other direction. And so they could double check all the readings on the instrument panel.
He speeds at 17,500 miles an hour, reaching a high point of 160 miles and a low altitude of 99 miles.
The problems I had during that first flight the first one was at the end of the first orbit. We had planned to make most of the flight on automatic control. And they had the gyros and they're hooked into the thrusters and so on. You have backups on that then, where I could operate all those same functions with the hand controller that we have on display out here. The automatic system failed. One of the thrusters stuck at the end of the first orbit. And so that was fouling up. It was using too much fuel. And we were going to have to cut the flight short if it kept doing that. So I cut the automatic systems off and went to manual control on that, and that was one of the things we'd wanted to prove, whether people could do this or not. We were going to do it on a longer basis, but when this emergency occurred, I just cut them all off, okay, roll, pitch, and yaw, same time, and controlled manually, which I had a lot of confidence we could do, or I could do.
Each of the three orbits takes about 90 minutes. Three times the colonel sees the sun rise within a period of 4 hours and 56 minutes. Three times around the globe for a trip of 81,000 miles before he re-enters the Earth's atmosphere, a shield protecting the astronaut from the intense heat.
Going over two of the ground stations, there had been an indication that the heat shield was loose. Now, ordinarily, when you come back in and make a re-entry, and you're falling straight down, you come down to about, when you finally get down to about 10,000 feet and the main chute comes out, is fired, it comes out, and then once you're on the main chute coming down, the whole heat shield is released from metal dogs like a watertight door. Those are pulled and the whole heat shield drops down about 4 feet. If that had been true, if the heat shield had been loose, then during re-entry, the whole thing would probably have burned up. So we left the retro packs, which sat right in the middle of the heat shield, and they're strapped onto the spacecraft by three metal straps. And they decided to leave the retro pack in place with those metal straps to hold the heat shield instead of releasing the retro pack as would be normal for a normal re-entry. It made then for a very spectacular re-entry from where I was, because when I was re-entering the atmosphere and all the burning was going on behind me, I could see out through the little window over my head these burning chunks of retro pack that were coming back by the window, and I couldn't be 100% certain whether they were heat shield or whether they were retro pack. It was burning up, but it was quite impressive from where I was with these chunks coming back by there.
There's the destroyer NOAA, and she speeds to the capsule to take the vehicle and pilot aboard. Despite a few shaky moments among ground control personnel, Glenn is down, hale and hearty. With support cables attached, a pincer-like crane will lift the Friendship 7 aboard.
Thank you.
of a saga. The now famous Friendship 7 is safely lashed to the deck of the destroyer, and the crew prepares to help Glenn from the capsule. First, they attempt to help the colonel from his complex prison through the upper exit in the mouth. They encounter difficulties, and so it is decided to blow off the escape hatch cover.
End of the flight, I was in good shape at the end of the flight. I was hot, but it was interesting that when I wanted to get out finally, and had made sure that all the sailors on the deck of the NOAA destroyer were not there right up close to the spacecraft if I was going to blow that hatch. And I hit the hatch with my knuckle through the silver glove, and the plunger, when it set off the charge, the charge in the explosive hatch, it kicked back enough that it split the skin here. And so that was my only wound from the whole flight, was a little skin knuckle here that happened getting out at the end of the flight.
First glimpse of the conquering hero, Colonel John H. Glenn. He left his footprints among the stars. He has a grin as wide as the path he blazed as he rests briefly before being flown to the carrier Randolph by helicopter. The helicopter takes him to the Randolph for a debriefing and examinations by medical men. The copter no sooner touches down on deck than Glenn gets a preview of the congratulations that are still to come. On every hand there is jubilation. On every side, smiles and cheers. He signs over his precious log and instruments to the National Space Administration. From here, he goes to Grand Turk Island for further rest before the deluge. A deluge of honors a proud country waits to bestow on a brave man.
It's quite exhilarating because there'd been some doubts about different things. We'd had some problems during the flight and had been able to overcome those, and we'd set out to show as a country that we could do this. So to bring off a successful mission meant a lot, and it meant a lot to me personally.